Now, just a couple of years ago, India used to be the toast of the world. Everyone used to look to India, and the word superpower was often used in India's context. But somehow the story has changed a little bit. I don't know if what my panelists think. None of you need any introduction at all, so I'm going to go straight into asking you a few questions about India, about how hopeful you all feel about India. And I want to start this off by asking all of you, what to you should be the top priority of the government now that it's taken charge in Delhi? What do you, if you were writing the to-do list for the Prime Minister, what would you say should be right on top? I'll start with you, Naina. Tell me, what would you say should be right on the top?
Well, growth. We need to bring growth back into the country. We have, as you know, dipped below 5% GDP growth, and it's critical that we bring this growth back up to 8% in the next couple of years, let's say the outside 3 years.
Is it possible?
It is, and in fact, our own planning commission, when it set these targets, laid out that 8% was possible with a few actions. Most research analysts are already saying next year would be a 6% plus, and then 7 and up to 8. Okay. So the belief generally is that it is possible. And then if you look at how that would be achieved, GST, that could add a couple of percent into the GDP of the country straight away. Yeah. You begin to then look at other growth agendas, whether it's to push manufacturing or the service sector.
So getting more people to pay tax, manufacturing is another sector. What about you, sir? What do you think? What should be, you're writing the to-do list.
Yeah.
What's on top? And you're not allowed to copy anything that Naina said.
The to-do list is very straightforward. You used two words earlier. One was hopeful. And I think we always were hopeful. I think what we have now is renewed energy. So I think the hope has always persisted. And absolutely correct, heading towards 8% growth in the next 2 to 3 years. I think the top item on the agenda has to be to rebuild business confidence as well as consumer confidence. And without which the growth numbers are not going to take off, new investment is not going to come in. And without a good climate, people are not going to write checks for a new investment. And the government certainly can't invest all that is required for the country.
But Mr. Birla, lots of people would say that actually this confidence is not coming back in a hurry, is it? Because, you know, look at all the indicators, look at the sort of mood globally when people sort of talk about India, you know, the sort of hope and the sort of, you know, people really wanted to put their money on India a few years ago. That's not the case anymore. Even, you know, we're sitting here in London talking about this. How do you renew this confidence?
You see, the consumer, why did I use the word consumer confidence? Right now, our industry is running at an average in most across most sectors at, say, 70 to 80% capacity utilization. Now, nobody's going to put in money when you're running at 80%. But if consumer confidence comes up and you see that maybe 24 months down the line, you're going to touch 100%, that is when you start planning today for an investment 2 years down the line.
Okay.
So this change is hopefully going to come rather rapidly.
Okay. Jusam, what do you think? I mean, what to you is the real, you know, one priority area?
Generate employment, and actually it's all interconnected. So to generate employment, you've got to create the conducive atmosphere for investment. And when investment comes, industry will thrive. And when industry thrives, there will be employment generated.
Exactly. I mean, lots of people say that, you know, India is such a young country. The median age of India is 26. So, you know, I mean, as a country, we are in our, you know, mid-20s. But where are all of these jobs going to come from?
Like I said, it's all interconnected, and if there is a conducive environment and investment takes place, industry gets energized, manufacturing, which is languishing, gets a push, automatically that employment will be generated. And as you said, we are the youngest country in the world. We will also end up being the youngest monster if we don't generate that employment.
What to you, sir, is the top priority?
You know, I think all these priorities that you've just heard mentioned will not happen till we can handle food inflation. Unless you handle food inflation, and when you say food inflation is only the tip of the iceberg. Actually, there's a whole issue of agriculture productivity, supply chain management, the whole works retail, you know, from, as they say, from fork to farm to fork kind of situation. Unless that gets done, the economy will not be able to get back on the rails in terms of whether it's consumers which have to come back into it, whether interest rates need to decline so that people can really actually put their money in and get into industry. So it's all linked up, but I think very important is right up there food inflation.
Food inflation. Now, I want to broaden this out a bit and want to ask all of you, here we are in London discussing, talking about India. So that this doesn't look like one of those chats where, all sort of desis are getting together and talking about India. I want to ask all of you, tell me, what to you can be the game changer in terms of businesses here working with India or working in India? What to you think is sort of one area that we haven't explored enough? Is it banks or infrastructure or where is it? Where do you find the sort of UK-India partnership?
So, let me start by saying, in fact, over the last 18 months, it is the UK companies that have put money back into India. Unilever, 3.5 billion, GSK, 2 billion, Diageo now. These are expressions of faith in the market, which in fact we were all despairing of, given that the growth had dipped, but it was in fact the UK companies that came forward. So I think for the UK companies that are in India, they have always seen that the opportunity is there and have therefore stayed the course through the wobbles that the economy has seen.
Okay.
New sectors, defense is going to be a big one. There's clearly a big...
Should there be more, should the cap be raised when it comes to defense?
Well, what do you think? I think the announcement and Fiki's proposal is in fact that defense be one that be open to 100%, albeit not across the board, because
that's pretty controversial, isn't it?
I don't think so. I think we want to see domestic industry grow.
Mm-hmm.
We do not want it to be just a foreign-owned sector. So we want to create the space for those Indian companies who are the big ones, the Tatas, the Mahindras, those that have expressed interest in the sector,
the
to build their business.
Okay. What about you, Mr. Britt? I mean, where do you think more British companies can sort of explore this potential in India?
I think definitely defense and bringing defense industry as part of a global value chain into India is probably going to make sense because India is today the largest importer of defense equipment in the world.
Yeah.
And British companies particularly have had a lot of interest. So I think there is scope for one area. Number two, I think if I haven't done my research in terms of specific areas, but in terms of concept, anything that could be manufactured in India as part of a global supply chain. I'll give you an example of what is happening in Thailand. For example, all the hard disks in the world, majority of the hard disks in the world are now being made in Thailand for supply to various people. Something as simple as golf gloves. I think there's one factory which manufactures all the golf gloves.
Why don't we manufacture those golf gloves in India? I mean, I always ask this question to, big businessmen like you. I mean, why don't we manufacture those golf gloves in India?
I think our... the mentality, the Indian mentality towards scale.
We just make cricket bats.
We make cricket bats, yes. We do make a lot of cricket bats, yes.
It's because of the Kashmir willow. And don't forget, Sachin Tendulkar's favorite bat was made out of Kashmir willow.
There you go. But more to the point, I mean, in terms of, companies here, what do you think and what's that one area that you think, apart from defense, you've already spoken about defense.
I think they can get very deeply involved with the infrastructure development. We've got these, the corridors coming up and there are some smart cities coming up. Urbanization is an area which they can certainly look at. So infrastructure is where I think the British companies should really look into.
Well, Virgin trains running from Delhi to Bombay and, crisscrossing the countries, perhaps?
Why not?
The railways as well.
Yeah.
Because there is a huge impetus being given to the railways.
But if they charge the kind of fares that are charged in this country, then, that government is never going to come back to power.
I think the mentality is coming around to if you provide a service and there is a segment which will pay for that service. And if we are going to have super speed bullet trains, so there'll be people who'll pay to get there in 12 hours compared to the 3 days it takes today.
Okay.
And another area
so
that...
You're saying that people will pay for that sort of a service?
I think they will.
What's that one thing you feel that we're not, selling ourselves hard enough, or that's one area that you think India can really, really should push and market itself here?
The market. The market itself. We have the world's largest sort of somewhat untapped market, 600 million people. Where are you going to get that? obviously British companies have to come. They have little other places to go to.
In one word, if you were to tell our audiences, what's that one word? When I say the word Indian economy, what's that one word that comes to your mind?
Excited.
Booming.
Okay.
Resurgent.
Skilling.